Good morning, my dear students. This is Dr. Alia Asi, your biology teacher, and today we are going to continue our second part of the photosynthesis, and today we are going to talk about the mechanism of photosynthesis. It is known that photosynthesis takes place in the plant, in the green leaves of the plant, when the plant takes carbon dioxide and water and produces what? Produces oxygen, exactly. But this produced oxygen, is it derived from carbon dioxide, the oxygen in the carbon dioxide, or the oxygen in the water? So today we are going to discuss what is the source of oxygen evolved during photosynthesis. The first one to think about this question was an American microbiologist called Van Niel. He was studying the photosynthesis process and he thought, where the oxygen comes from? Is it evolving from the carbon dioxide or from the water? So he made a couple of experiments to know that. The first experiment he did it on a bacteria called purple sulfur bacteria or green sulfur bacteria. Purple and green sulfur bacteria, as you can see here in the photo, they are bacteria that live in swamps, and they are autotrophs, sorry. They can synthesize their own food, but instead of using water, they use hydrogen sulfide that is abundant, present in very large amount in the swamps they live in. And instead of having plastids, they have bacterial chlorophyll. Bacterial chlorophyll is very similar to the plant chlorophyll, but it is simpler, but do the same job. What he found is that the bacteria used hydrogen sulfide instead of water to reduce the carbon dioxide to produce carbohydrates, and instead of water evolving, he found that there is sulfur precipitating. So let's see what happened. Van Niel assumed that the light decomposes hydrogen sulfide into hydrogen and sulfur. And because the light is the main factor affecting this reaction, he called it the light reaction. So we have hydrogen sulfide in presence of light energy and bacterial chlorophyll, it split into hydrogen and sulfur. And because of sulfur is solid substance, it precipitated. The resulted hydrogen from the above equation was used to reduce carbon dioxide to produce carbohydrate, and this reaction doesn't require light, so he called it the dark reaction. So we have the 12 hydrogen that was produced above, combining with the carbon dioxide. Do we need light? No, but we need the chlorophyll, and this process is called reduction. What do we get? We get one molecule of glucose plus, exactly, 6 water. So the general chemical photosynthesis equation in sulfur bacteria, we combine these two equations together. So we start with 12 hydrogen sulfide, and what else? Exactly, carbon dioxide, 6 carbon dioxide. Do we need light? Yes, of course. And in bacterial chlorophyll. What is the result? One molecule of glucose plus 6 water, and don't forget the precipitated sulfur. So in this case, we didn't have any evolved oxygen. But in case of plants, what happened? The light decomposes water into hydrogen and oxygen into a light reaction. So we have 12 water were split or decomposed by the light energy in the chlorophyll. What do we get? We get 12 hydrogen plus exactly 6 oxygen, which is evolved. The resulted hydrogen is used to reduce the carbon dioxide, exactly like the same reaction, nothing different here. We have 1 glucose and 6 water. So the general chemical photosynthesis equation in green plants is 12 water, 6 carbon dioxide, we need light energy, and in presence of chlorophyll, we get 1 molecule of glucose plus 6 water, and exactly evolved oxygen. So from this we can conclude that the oxygen source in green plant in photosynthesis is water, exactly, because when we removed the water, we didn't get oxygen. When we used hydrogen sulfide instead of water, we get sulfur instead of oxygen. Sulfur bacteria don't produce oxygen during photosynthesis, but they produce sulfur instead of the oxygen, because they use hydrogen sulfide instead of the water. Some other scientists in 1941 in the University of California needed to make sure that Van Niels' theory is right. So what did they do? They made another experiment. They used green chlorella algae. The algae was placed in a suitable condition to perform photosynthesis, but we had two experiments. In one experiment, they provided the algae with normal water and carbon dioxide containing oxygen isotope. We know what's an isotope. An isotope is a very similar atom to the original atom, but the number of neutrons is different. Okay, so they have the same number of protons, the same number of electrons, but the number of neutrons inside the atom is different. Okay, so the normal oxygen is O16, but they used O18 instead. So in one experiment, they provided the algae with normal water and isotope in the carbon dioxide, oxygen isotope in the carbon dioxide. The other experiment, they provided the algae with water containing oxygen isotope and normal carbon dioxide. And this is what an isotope is. So in experiment one was normal water or water with isotope. It was normal water, and the carbon dioxide was with the isotope. In experiment B, the water was the isotope and the carbon dioxide was normal. Can you guess what they observed? In the first experiment, did they have normal oxygen evolving or oxygen isotope? Exactly. They received or have normal evolved oxygen because the source of oxygen is water. And in the other experiment, we have isotope oxygen in the water. The evolved oxygen was an isotope. The equation. In the first experiment, we have carbon dioxide with an isotope and water with normal oxygen. We had the carbohydrates with the isotope oxygen, and the water with the isotope oxygen, but the evolved oxygen was normal. And it was the reverse in the second experiment. The evolved oxygen was the isotope, and the oxygen present in the carbohydrates and in the water produced was normal. So our conclusion, this confirms Van Niels' theory that the evolved oxygen is coming from the water, or the water is the source of the evolved oxygen. So let's go to the light and dark reaction. What is light and dark reaction? We mentioned that in Van Niels' theory. Van Niels stated that this photosynthesis process occurs in two steps. The first one is the decomposition of water by light, and it's called light reaction. And the second is the reduction of carbon dioxide by hydrogen to produce carbohydrate, and this is a dark reaction. And when we say dark reaction, it doesn't mean that we need dark. It doesn't mean that it's essential to be dark. No, it means that we don't need light. So either in presence of light or not, the dark reaction can occur. This was first discovered by Frederick Blackmon in 1905, who is a British physiologist, during his studying the factor affecting photosynthesis. And he found that there is three limiting factors, or he studied some limiting factors like light, like temperature, and like carbon dioxide. What is the effect of these three factors on the photosynthesis process? And according to these factors, he divided the photosynthesis reactions into light reaction, which is sensitive to light, and dark reaction or enzymatic reaction, which are sensitive to temperature. So let's start with the light reaction. Light reaction is a group of reactions that occurs in the grana inside the green plastid, or what we call the chloroplast. The chloroplast contain chlorophyll, exactly, the pigment, the green pigment. And the green pigment, if we remember, in the plastid, the main job of the green pigment chlorophyll is to absorb sunlight or light. In this case, the light is a limiting factor for the rate of the reaction, and the light reaction occurs in a chain of steps, as we will see next. First, the light falls on the chlorophyll present in the grana and convert the inactive chlorophyll into active chlorophyll, making the electrons excited. The electrons are transferred from low energy level to high energy level. So the kinetic energy of the light is stored in chlorophyll in the form of chemical potential energy. Thus, the chlorophyll molecules are in excited or activated state. What happens next to the excited or active chlorophyll? When the absorbed energy is released from the chlorophyll, the electrons fall again to lower energy level, making the chlorophyll again stable. Okay? So what happens with the energy? Part of this energy is released to split up water to give us oxygen and hydrogen. First, the hydrogen combine with a messenger called NAD or NADP, okay, which is nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide phosphate, NADP, converting the NAD into NADPH2. So NADP, when combining with hydrogen, we get NADPH2. Why do we need to combine the hydrogen with this NADP molecule? Because if we have hydrogen alone, it can recombine again with the oxygen, forming water. So what the light did can be reversed. So we need to capture the hydrogen before recombining again with the oxygen. And the NADH deliver this hydrogen to the dark reaction. And for the oxygen, it is evolved. How about the second part, or the remaining part of the energy? As we said, a part of the energy splits the water. What happens to the other part? The other part of the energy is released and stored by the ADP. ADP is adenosine diphosphate, which doesn't have energy. When it combines with another phosphate group in presence of energy, they form adenosine triphosphate, which we know as ATP. And this ATP is stored in the cell until it is needed. And ATP, as we know, is the energy currency in the cell. And this process of producing ATP during the photosynthesis process is called photosynthetic phosphorylation. Photosynthetic phosphorylation. And also ATP is removed to the dark reaction. So we have two things here that enters in the dark reaction, the hydrogen carried by the NADP in the form of the NADP H2 and energy carried in the form of ATP. So this sums up: when the light energy is absorbed by chlorophyll A, it becomes active, and then the active chlorophyll A releases energy. Some of this energy split water, giving us two hydrogen and one molecule of oxygen. The hydrogen combined with NADP to give us NADPH, which goes to the dark reaction. Oxygen is released or evolved as a secondary product. The other part of the energy convert ADP or adenosine diphosphate into adenosine triphosphate or ATP, which is the energy currency in the cell, and it is carried also to the dark reaction. So now we are ready to start the dark reaction or the enzymatic reaction. They are a group of reactions that occurs in the stroma, so we don't need the chlorophyll now. We are still inside the chloroplast, but not in the granum. Yes, we are in the stroma, the matrix of the plastid. The temperature is the limiting factor for the rate of this reaction because it needs some enzymes, and as we know, enzymes are very much affected by temperature, and they can occur either in light or darkness. The name dark reaction doesn't require them to be in the dark. In this reaction, carbon dioxide gas is fixed by combining it with hydrogen carried on NADPH2 with the help of the energy stored in the ATP to form the carbohydrates. And that's why we say that NADPH2 and ATP are called energy-fixing compound, because we use them to fix the carbon dioxide to form carbohydrates, which is a way to store energy in plants. In 1949, Melvin Calvin, who is an American biochemist at the California University, used the newly discovered carbon isotope to discover the nature of dark reaction, to study the dark reaction. So carbon isotope, carbon 14, is also a type of isotope for carbon. So what did Melvin Calvin do? He used chlorella algae. He placed it in this type of apparatus, in a special container, and he exposed this container to containing carbon dioxide containing carbon 14 isotope. Okay? And in this container, he exposed it to light for only few seconds to allow the photosynthesis to start, and then very fast he pours the algae into alcohol to kill the algae and stop the reaction. What did he find? Next, he separated the formed compounds and tested for the radioactive carbon isotope using this apparatus. It's very easy to test for any radioactive isotope. It's called Grazer counter, which we use to detect isotopes. So what did Melvin find? He found that after 2 seconds of light exposure, a compound containing only 3 carbon atoms was formed, and he called it phosphoglyceraldehyde, or PGAL, phosphoglyceraldehyde. PGAL is the first stable compound from photosynthesis. And also PGAL is used in building glucose, starch, proteins, and fats. So it's a primary product of photosynthesis, and it is used to build more complicated products of the photosynthesis. And in case we don't have glucose, the mitochondria can use the PGAL to produce the energy. After a while, he found that the PGAL was converted into glucose or hexose sugar. So he detected that, or he assumed that hexose sugars like glucose are not synthesized in one step. They are first synthesized as 3 carbon molecule, P Spiegel, and then this Spiegel makes the hexose sugar. And these reactions are catalyzed by specific enzymes, so they are controlled by temperature. And as you can see here, we can see the relation between the light and dark reaction. We can see on our left side the light reaction, where it happens in, exactly, it happens in the grana, where the chlorophyll absorbs the light, and we take the water, split it into oxygen. We have the water split into oxygen by the light. Oxygen is evolved, and ATP is formed, and NADPH is also formed. They go to the dark reaction outside in the stroma, entering Calvin cycle or the dark reaction. What happens here? The hydrogen in the NADPH reduce the carbon dioxide to produce sugar using the ATP produced from the light reaction to produce sugar. Okay? And then the ATP is converted again to ADP and phosphate, enter the light reaction to get more energy, to form more ATP, to get again into Calvin cycle, and the NADPH loses the hydrogen, become NADP again, goes again to the light reaction to get more hydrogen, and it's a cycle. Okay? So let's compare between the light and dark reaction. Site of occurrence for the light reaction, it occurs in the grana. For the dark reaction, exactly, in the stroma. Limiting factor, light reaction, light. Dark reaction, do we need dark? No. The limiting factor is temperature. Perfect. Mechanism, or what happens during the light reaction? The conversion of kinetic energy of light to chemical potential energy. While in the dark reaction, fixation or reduction of carbon dioxide by combining with hydrogen to produce carbohydrates, and this is in presence of NADPH and ATP. What are the products of the light reaction? We have three products. The first is the hydrogen combined with the NADP forming NADPH2. The second is oxygen gas, which is a secondary product. And the third is energy stored in the form of ATP. What are the products of the dark reactions? We have Pgal, which is used, the first product. We can say it's the precursor for the formation of any other complex carbohydrate or protein or fat. And we have water. And Pgal also is used in cellular respiration as a high energy compound in case we don't have glucose. Thank you so much. Thank you for your attention and for being here. Hope you enjoyed our lesson and see you next time. Have a great day.